The Wednesday Week is sponsored by the Riverside Cafe, new outside bar, now open on match days.
Gentlemen, and a very warm welcome to the Wednesday Week, the Sheffield Wednesday podcast. I'm Lord Hillsborough, and with me online, first of all, we have Mr. Malliott. How are you, James Obi?
Hello, good evening. So it's National Penguin Day today. I've been trying to come up with like a penguin joke to start the podcast with, but I can't. But I do know a good joke about a duck. Do you want to hear it?
Of course. Right. Why wouldn't we want to?
How do you make a duck sing?
I don't know. How do you make a duck sing, James Jolby?
You put it in the microwave until it's Bill Withers.
Wow.
Target reference.
Wow.
I was in a meeting about music all day today. I don't know if you can tell.
Well, apparently not with that reference, Jolby. Were you in a music about meeting in 1972?
It was about then, yeah.
And Mr. Fudgy, Jolby, now the devil are you?
I'm not bad. I've got a joke about a penguin. Penguin's car broke down, so he took it to the walrus to go and get it fixed. And he said, "I'm just going to pop off for an hour." He came back, and the walrus said to him, "I know what's up. You've blown a seal." He went, "I haven't. I've just had an ice cream."
Wednesday Week, ladies and gentlemen, bring you the very best in penguin humour.
Penguin-based humour. Yeah, I'm all right, Lord Ace. How's everybody else? All right?
Much better now for hearing that joke, Dolby. And chaps, we've got somewhat of a stranger on the line with us. Somebody's crept in the back door, as he tends to do. Mr. Hoyland's here with us. Eddie, old boy, where the chup have you been?
You know what? I've spent the last 6 weeks AWOL trying to find penguin jokes, and I had absolutely nothing. The only thing I've got today, and this is hot off the presses, is today's news. File it under not all heroes wear capes. Today it's been reported that 3 ISIS fighters have been killed by wild boars on Iraqi farmland. They were trying to clear the area of wild boars, presumably because they were, providing false positives when they're looking for people to shoot. The boars went on a rampage and killed 3 ISIS militants. So a spokesman said that the ISIS members took revenge on the pigs. So big up the pigs. I don't often say that on this podcast. So there you go. That's animal news for this week.
I was waiting for a punchline on that. I was waiting for the spokesman said.
Do you need a punchline in a story about ISIS being attacked by wild boars?
No, fair. I'll give him that.
Wild boars.
Wild boars. Wild boars. Wow, we're going through the decades tonight on a Wednesday Week. It's 70s first, followed by the 80s, the great sounds of Duran Duran. And soon we've got Pat O'Banton with Baby Come Back.
Oh, dear. Right then, ladies and gents, let's crack on with some Wednesday news, because we've got a lovely little match to talk about, chaps. I mean, oh, my word, the Derby game. It was eventually tremendous, wasn't it?
So it's what, 17 attempts, or is it 17 years that was since we've beaten Derby, or there was some ridiculous
11
thing,
11 years 17 11 years, attempts
17 attempts and not a single victory against Derby. I mean, we are seriously doing our best at the moment, aren't we, in terms of turning around some serious hoodoos. You know, we've beaten a Warnock team, we've won at QPR, now we've beaten Derby. Ipswich next on the list. It's been
written
a while.
In the stars.
Yep, not got written a great record against big teams, have we? Right, my take on the Derby game is pretty simple. I thought that we played really well. I thought that first half we were the better team. We were quite unlucky. I thought second half Derby came out a different team and got got a relatively fortunate goal, I suppose, but they were on top at the time. And then we showed some real grit, some real determination. We got what you'd have to put down as being a fairly lucky goal for us as an equaliser, although you have to give huge credit to the players that were involved in that goal, particularly Gary Hooper. And then we went on and we got the winner. And it was richly deserved because we were the better team.
Absolutely. I think you're right in mentioning Gary Hooper. Since he's come back, we've been excellent, and we've waxed lyrically about it on this show many, many times before. In fact, Eddie, yeah, nothing's really changed since you've been away. His movement and his intelligence around the football field is absolutely world class. I mean, I don't even know if he does it. I don't even know if it's like a conscious decision or just does he think, like most footballers should, there is a man stood near me. If I move here, this man may follow me. And it did. And it seemed to work every time. And then let's not forget, we're probably going to get there in a minute. You know, Jose Semedo's having a run out. I'm assuming this is just a ploy just to make sure he gets a medal at the end of the season if we go up or something like that. Because I can't seem to see any other reason for bringing him on. But Gary Hooper for me.
That's awful. Jose is still doing a job showing up that defence, protecting our leads.
I'm sorry, but the way we wax on about Jose Semedo is it's embarrassing.
Wash your mouth out, you filthy little chopper.
You've got to give credit to Carlos here. In terms of his substitutions on Saturday, they were absolutely superb because Hooper did play well, but he wasn't anything like as effective in the first half as he was in the second half when Jordan Rhodes came on. And we changed shape a little bit. And that gave Gary Hooper that little bit more freedom because he got that out-and-out striker playing with him, and it allowed Hooper to kind of move around a little bit more. But then obviously when we go 2-1 ahead, you don't want to have three strikers on the pitch, so bringing on a defensive minded player as the only one that we've got on the bench is Semedo, to bring him on to shore up the defence, and it worked. You can't say it didn't work. It worked brilliantly.
I think it's one of these examples, and we've had quite a few this season and last, where this was not, as much as it was a great execution from the players, and they do that generally week in, week out. This was another example of a tactical masterclass by Carlos. And you know what? You can't legislate for that goal catching us cold at the start of the second half. It's a Wednesday trait. It's something that we have battled against for years. And Carlos doesn't have the answer to that any more than any manager does. Derby came out, all guns blazing. And they got a goal. I agree. I think the goal was probably lucky, but they did exactly what you expect an away team to do when they are, you know, trying to put a team like us under pressure. And we didn't deal with it. What Carlos then did was change things in exactly the way that unpicked what Derby were doing. They were compact. They were dealing very easily with a front two of Fletcher and Hooper. As much as Hooper was pulling people around and doing the things that he did, it wasn't really unlocking Derby the way that we wanted to do. So we changed it up with Rhodes coming in. It changed the game completely. Hoop could drop deeper. He actually dragged. Derby didn't adapt to the fact that we went to a front three. Hooper managed to drag the central defenders out with him as he dropped deeper, and it created that space behind. And, you've called it absolutely perfectly that Carlos made the changes that were needed at the time they were needed. And he created a situation where there were mismatches all over the field for us, got the two goals, and then went, okay, now, job done. We're going to bring in the spoiler. We're going to bring in Semedo, who, and I know we do blow smoke up his arse a little bit on this podcast because he's one of our own.
A little bit.
Yeah. We do a little bit. But you know what? I'll only say a little bit because so much of it is deserved. When this season, when he's been brought on to be a shoring up, a finisher, in the parlance of Major League Baseball, a closer, a guy whose job is not to impress anybody, just to shut down the game and finish it off. Has he made a single mistake? I can't think of one.
Right. Jose Semedo is only in that squad by virtue of the fact that Hutchinson's out and his replacement is essentially Dave Jones. That's why he's in there. We all know that. That's what's happening. Surely we're not going to discuss that, what that is. And secondly, it's the easiest position on the pitch. Oh. It really is. As a 36-year-old man, I play Sunday League there now because I'm too much of a liability at centre-back because I can't run anymore. It's easier for me to be 6'3", stand there, edit back, kick a geezer and just hoof it. And that's what Semedo does. And yes, don't get me wrong, I agree with you. There are times, especially in games such as that, where that sort of role is needed, where, you know, there are those type of things that need to happen on a football pitch in order to ensure the 3 points. But Jose Semedo isn't championship quality, let alone Premier League or
Could not disagree more. Jose, he's Portuguese. Jose, not Jose.
Absolutely, yeah.
Sorry, well, yeah, I've got to pull you up on that. Yeah. A well-travelled gentleman as such as yourself.
I know.
Fudge, I've got to ask you a question off the back of that. Your Sunday League team, how are you doing?
Yep. We are mid-table in the lowest league in Southampton. So, you know, we're virtually the same, me and Jose.
Did I not see a little tweet from Mr. Peacock mentioning that you may have had to exit the proceedings early last week, oh boy?
Yeah, I got sent off. Yeah, well, what it was, me, he rang me up and he went, "Where are you?" And I went, "Oh, I'm at home." And he said, "No, I'm in Bedford Place, which is the area of Southampton where I live." And he went, "I'm with some lads from Manchester." It turns out he met these guys when he was playing for City. And Saints were playing City that day, so they'd gone down and had a watch. And I thought, "Yeah, I'll meet you for a pint." I only stayed out for one. 3 a.m., I am off my bonce in Revolution, yamming. But, you know, awful flavoured vodkas, trying to outdo, you know, just a big dick measuring competition, trying to outdo each other on what the worst shot is that can conceivably get to a man. And the morning after, I was absolutely waist gashed and got sent off just because I needed a rest and we used all three subs.
Oh, bless you. But no, I think Jose has a role to play. I think he's proved it many times this season. I think he's made some very important challenges. And to be honest, for the ladies, after the game, when he's on the pitch and he removes his shirt, oh, it's a sight to behold. Isn't it?
that body. I tell you what, we settled down to watch the extended highlights, or it might even have been the commentary. You know, the commentary box stuff with JP and my boy O'Neill, and they kind of intercut it with scenes from the ground. I don't think Laura really has given enough attention to Jose Semedo because he doesn't play as much as some other players. But she saw him, and I tell you what, the word wide on doesn't even come close.
Edward.
She was all over that loving. I tell you, there's a reason why Cristiano Ronaldo keeps Jose around, and that's because he needs something to aspire to.
Yeah,
the man is magnificent. And you know what? While I'm on it, while I'm ranting, you can't say that Dave Jones can do the same job as a spoiler for Jose Semedo. Dave Jones is an all-around sideways passing Michael Carrick.
Yeah, he is. He's more of a Gareth Barry, Michael Carrick.
Exactly.
I get that.
Jose Semedo is an absolute hacker. And he's and he is preeminent in his role because you don't get him in the Premier League. You don't get just spoilers in the Premier League. Everyone has to be able to play. So actually, Jose Semedo is probably the very best at his position in English football today.
Because he's the only one doing it. You know what I mean? Since Billy Jones retired, nobody else is doing it. Like, you know what I mean?
He's a throwback, but hey, he gets it done.
you should work in advertising. It reminds me of those old episodes of Bewitched. Do you know what I mean?
Jose Semedo. He gets it done.
Like, "Hi, I'm Jose Semedo. And if you want to break down your attack, try this. It's a big kick."
That's it. He's the Barry Scott of the Championship. Bang!
And the attack is gone.
Oh dear. But I think there was some other good performance. I thought Mr. Lee played very well. And how lovely was it to see Kizer Lee back on the pitch again?
Yeah, it was good. It was quite unexpected, wasn't it? David Jones was a bit poorly. Fairly late change with Kieran Lee coming back into the team. It was good to see him bombing around. It was actually, I mean, strangely enough, I don't think it was a game that overly suited him. And he didn't get a great deal of opportunity to really show what he could do. But he was eager to get out there. And, I mean, he put himself about, didn't he? He ran all over the shop. And it was just, there was just something nice about actually seeing him back in a Wednesday shirt and back out there playing. It was great to see.
Oh, I think it gave the entire sort of crowd a bit of a boost as well to see him back. And I mean, after the horrendous injury and the operations and everything else that he's had, how well has he done to get back to that level of fitness so quickly? I wouldn't expect him to see him probably until halfway through next season with an injury like that. It's brilliant.
I was actually concerned about the whole thing. I thought, have we rushed him back in order to ensure that we have a decent run into the season? But he genuinely put a performance in like somebody who'd been playing for a couple of weeks, which you know, is great. And I'm very happy about the whole thing. But there was still a slight inkling there where my little tea towel holder was 5p, 50p the whole time, thinking he's going to be out for 6 months by the end of this game.
Some of these references this evening, I'm not lying, they're starting to scare me, chaps. They're starting to scare me. But no, I mean, one thing we have to speak about as well in that game is Hooper's finish for his goal. That technique is incredible, isn't it? Absolutely chuffing incredible. To have that ball coming down, be running the wrong way, hit it along the floor to the space where there's nobody there, I just thought was amazing. That really is Hooper at his best, isn't it? Just that bit of
whether
technique.
It's injuries that he's had, or whether it's the fact that he's kind of been overshadowed by players that we've brought in since. You know, if we think back to when we first got him on loan, you know, kind of in the depths of the winter last season, we were all so excited, weren't we, with the idea, Gary Hooper, proven championship goal scorer, a guy who's cut it in the Premier League, he was coming to our club, we were finally showing that we were getting the right sort of players of the calibre that we needed. And since then, we've signed basically a who's who of what strikers you would want if you were a championship team. And I feel like sometimes Gary Hooper has kind of got lost in the shuffle a little bit because we're always raving about somebody else and the injuries haven't helped. But I honestly think that he is the most complete forward that we have. He doesn't excite you like Forestieri does. He doesn't have the goal-scoring record in recent years that Rhodes has, and he doesn't have the kind of international pedigree that Fletcher's built up. But what he does have is a complete control and command of the role he's expected to play. And I think it's genius that Carlos hasn't asked him to do anything different. He hasn't used those four strikers, or even Nuiu, if you want to include five, as interchangeable parts all doing the same thing. They all have a role to play. And I think Carlos has realised, and, you know, the fans, you know, we sit there in the stands and we can see it plain as day, that Gary Hooper enables so much to happen. And I'm just so glad that actually he isn't just being selfless and he's getting the reward which every striker wants, which is to score goals. And, you know, you've called that. That technique was absolutely stunning.
Absolutely.
Here's a question. Does anyone remember a guy called Sam Winall, who we signed from Barnsley in January? He was last seen scoring against Barnsley, and I don't think he's been seen since.
Never.
Yeah, he's going to struggle, isn't he? But then again, we all kind of feared, not feared, but I think deep down we knew that that was going to happen. We knew that he was probably going to fall behind Nando, Jordan, Gary. That sounds weird just saying Gary. You know what I mean?
Got it.
It just seems weird just saying it. But yeah, gal. You know what I mean? Imagine having a daughter and then going, oh, I've got a boyfriend, Dad. Already your back's up. What's his name? Gal. Oh, get in the bin. You know what I mean? But we knew he'd fall down the pecking order behind all those people. And there was a point where him and Rhodes were looking like our tastiest partnership. But that was only last month. And it's whatever cliche you can think of, horses for courses, round pegs for round holes, there are games that where we need a Sam Winall and his work rate and that sort of thing. But at the minute, we don't need that right now. We just need to go Thee Cockerels to the country file and, you know, smash it in. And Gary Winall, bloody hell fire, I'm on fire tonight, aren't I? Sam Winall fits into a certain type of play because we are famous. We're famous in the Championship for being slow burners and slow starters. And when you've got somebody up front in that slow start grafting away like Winall does, it's actually a tactic that works well for Carlos and has got us into the position we've got now. Albeit, you know, annoying me to death every step of the way. but you know, there's space for him and. You never know. Let's say if we get to the final, Sam Winall for the first half might actually be a decent idea.
I think I said it on the podcast when we signed him. I regard Sam Winall as a project. You know, remember in the Premier League where we signed players like, you know, like a Richard Creswell, and I know where he went after and blah, 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 blah. I can remember at the time thinking we spent, was it 800 grand or £1 million or something on Richard Creswell from York. He's got a hatful of goals in the lower leagues. He's a project. He's a guy that has the raw materials to groom into something better than he is. And actually, I think a Sam Winnall becomes a much better player training and playing alongside, you know, your Hoopers, your Fletchers, these, you know, and Jordan Rhodes, who's not a spring chicken anymore. Players who have been there and done it. So actually, I'm quite happy with us signing Sam Winnall and not really playing him. I think he's got something to offer, but I don't think he's the finished article. Because I actually think that he could become the finished article. You know, we're a club that is looking to take it to the next level. If we go up to the Premier League, immediately we're going to have to be spending money on players that is going to dwarf what we regard as the amount of money that we've spent on this team that we've assembled to challenge at the top end of the Championship. So why not take a couple of punts on players who are who have raw potential, in the same way that David Hurst had raw potential, and groom them. That's a different way that I usually use that phrase. Groom them to become something that is going to be of real value to us when we get up there. Because honestly, Sam Winnall could be a top Premier League striker. He's not there now, but playing around the players that we've got with that experience that they have, it can only make him better. And it won't happen overnight.
Oh, absolutely. And another, the last little bit from the Derby game, I would like to give a bit of a shout to Mr. Reach as well, because he's had some pelters this season. I thought he played really, really well against Derby. Nothing particularly spectacular, but his work rate was fantastic. The cross for the goal was fantastic. And even the first goal, he actually got tackled and got back up straight away and won the ball back, if you like, and sort of on came the first goal. I just thought he played really, really well. And after the crap he's had from the Wednesday nights, just worth a mention. That's all.
I tell you, Lord Hillsborough, even Dirk off Twitter said that Reach played well. Now, those that are on Twitter will know that that is a big thing right there.
I think we could probably go a step further with Adam Reach, because I was one of the people that was giving him a little bit of stick earlier in the season, because it had nothing to do with his price tag. It was just due to the fact that he really wasn't doing anything. He wasn't adding anything to the team. And yet that's a good kind of 4, 5, 6 good games in a row that he's had now. And he's kind of come into his own a bit. I think he's found his place. I think he's settled into his game. He's got a bit of confidence. I think fans are behind him. And he's really responding to it. I think he's playing brilliantly at the moment. I think we've also got to give a special mention as well for Kieran Westwood, for his save late on in that game, because that was like a superhuman save from Westwood, because that was 2-2 written all over it. That was throwing it away last minute, same old Wednesday, absolutely written all over it, and I thought he did a tremendous job. And it was great all game as well, Westwood.
Absolutely. He really is becoming an absolute legend. I mean, I'm a big fan of goalkeepers in general, and I'm struggling now to not put him up there with the very, very best keepers I've ever seen in Hillsborough. And I'm a big, big fan. And after that save, obviously the ball sailed over the net, and Mr. Padil, did you see him sort of just leaning casually against the goalpost once he did that? If you haven't seen that, boys and girls, have a little look back. He's sat there quite happily thinking, Westwood's got it. It's not a problem.
It reminded me of a scene out of Kez. You know where he's in that scene with Brian Glover and he's in goal. It reminds me of that, where he's just leant against a goalpost. It really looked like that.
Love it, absolutely love it. And the other thing, just ever so quickly, I'm sure you guys saw it. Our silent partner on the podcast, editing Richard, noticed that when the ball went out at one point, one of the stewards jumped for the ball and ended up tumbling down the steps as well. So if you missed that, have a little look over there at our Twitter field. Scroll down. Hilarious. Absolutely chuffing hilarious. Bless him.
Here's a question. Where would you find all of the following in one place? Chairs, tables, beer, Vic, James, more beer, Dickie Owl, Eddie, more beer, and the rest of the Wednesday Week gang. That's right, it's the Riverside Cafe's new outside bar. All of your favourite lagers, ciders, soft drinks and hand pump ales are now available outside. Come and see the gang and give it a try. The Riverside Cafe's new outside bar. now open on match days.
Right then, ladies and gents, again, let's crack on with the, I have to say, scant bit of Wednesday news we've got. But what we have got is chuffing tremendous. The under-23s are now champions of their league. They have won the league. How chuffing wonderful is that?
Well, well, given it's got your favourite player in the world playing for them right now, I bet it was a lot more than Beastie dropping his fruit bag.
Well, I did have the obviously his entire face tattooed across my back, and now I'm going to pour sort of smaller George Hurst in different positions down the back of my legs.
I do not want to know what position you're gonna.
Yeah, that worries me.
Various goal scoring positions, shall we say.
Again, you see, that can be construed wrong. You see, you can't go to gay bars with language like that because everything means something else, Lord H, you see. So what, you're just going to get yourself in a right load of trouble, and, you know, we don't need that for you.
Some say fun.
Yeah, Mrs. Lord H don't need that, you know what I mean?
She's used to it, old boy. But no, it really, I mean, we've banged on about the youth quite a lot this year. Obviously, we mentioned that this was a possibility a couple of weeks ago. But it really just goes to show the how things have changed in our youth setup. And I know we've mentioned that before as well, but this is essentially the proof to the pudding, isn't it? How hard are those guys working down there?
You know what, it was a decade ago, probably not much more than that. We'd open the programme and flick through to the development section and they'd say, and Sheffield Wednesday's under 18 slipped to a disappointing 6-0 defeat against Stocksbridge Blind School, under sevens. Look how far we've come. It's fantastic. And it goes to show the amount of investment and change that has gone on behind the scenes in the club. And this is probably the most visible way that you can describe that. It's amazing that we have won a league. One question that I do have that hasn't been answered yet, I hope one of our Twitter followers or even one of you fine gentlemen can answer. Now we've won the Division 2 title, does that mean we get promoted into Division 1 next season? Or is it the case that it's governed by, you know, what level we're at as an academy or, what the team is playing at?
I think it's that you are governed as to what level you're in as to the grading of your facilities, I believe. Or that, I'm pretty sure when they brought out the developmental squad programme, I'm pretty sure that was the thing. But I'm impressed that you managed to go through old school Sheffield Wednesday youth without mentioning Luke Bowden, for one.
Well done, Eddie.
I'm really proud of you there. The best thing is that finally Bods is lifting a trophy, isn't he, this week? He's finally made it. Presumably he's the captain of that team, isn't he?
No, he must be.
I would imagine so. While we are speaking about the youth as well, it has to be said that our younger youth as well have been out in Barcelona playing in the Barcelona Cup, and they actually got through to the final against Barcelona as well. These are the really younger chaps. So was a tweet sent out by the one of the chaps over there from SWFC, a Mr. Callum Oakenfold, that sounds like a character from The Hobbit. But it's a lovely little tweet. So we have retweeted it as I am speaking now from the TWWcast Twitter feed. So please have a little look at the video and you'll see the kids playing over there as well. It's fantastic. Brilliant. Absolutely. Chuffing. Love it.
Are we going to send them like a present to say well done, like some bread or some Battenberg or something?
We can send them Fudge's new penguin joke book. They'll love that.
I'm pretty sure that's a top seller. It's just going to be a napkin with that Walrus gag written on it. That's what it's going to be.
Right, well, the next little bit of Wednesday news. I've just seen a little tweet, actually, boys and girls. I've popped this in the chat as we're speaking, actually, because I've only just seen it. But it turns out Carlos has been at the Reverend of the Makers gig this evening, and a chap over there on Twitter, at Matty Wayne on Twitter, has got himself a little video of Carlos bopping along to the Makers. He seems to be thoroughly enjoying himself as well.
How much has Carlos become... like an actual Sheffielder in less than 2 years. You know, firstly, he's doing his press conference. He's talking about how the Sheffield people say a birate. And now he's going to, it's like Sheffield legendary stuff. You know, let's get the lead mill. Let's go to Rev. That's unbelievable that Carlos is representing that.
He's got his flat cap on and everything as well, hasn't he?
I've got issues with Carlos. Carlos, if you're listening, I'm not sure that we're friends anymore. On Saturday after the game, I had to go to the ticket office to sort out a ticketing problem. And as I left, I was first in the ticket office straight after the match, so I got it sort of pretty quickly. So walked back down the back of the south stand. I was going across the bridge and then turning right towards the Riverside Cafe. And as I was in like the very slow kind of like plod up the stairs across the bridge following everyone else, I heard a woman behind me go, "Excuse me, coming through, excuse me." And it was, I assume, some kind of security person from Sheffield Wednesday who was leading Carlos through the crowd. He was obviously in a rush to get straight off after the game, hence why Lee Bullen did all the interviews and everything. I'd had a couple of drinks, and as he went through, I thought, I know what would be really funny now. So I tried to get a chorus of Carlos Give Us a Wave going, which was just me, basically. No one joined in. And Carlos completely ignored me, didn't even acknowledge me. So me and Carlos, we're not friends anymore. We're nothing.
Listen,
dead to me.
James,
dead to me.
I'm aware how drunk you get at games. Now, I've been in Meadowhall, Christmas shopping. I've also been, you know, other shopping centres are available. And I've seen middle-aged women pulling children through crowds, going, "Excuse me, get out of the way, sorry." It's normally a lost child or something like that. Are you sure it was Carlos that in your, you know, your beer-tinted specs, you've thought that a child, because he's not the biggest fella in the world, you know what I mean? Have you thought that it was just a lost child?
It might just have been someone else in a nice coat. I don't know. No, it was. It was definitely Carlos.
These coats.
But you know, there's been times that I've employed a small child, put him in a coat that looks like Carlos, then dragged him around Meadowhall, going, excuse me, coming through, just so I can get to Primark quicker.
Yeah, so if you want to hire a child, get on to hireachild.org.co.uk. Yeah, you must be CRB check.
This is going wrong.
All children are vetted.
Actually, James, I've got an issue with Carlos this week as well. Now, as you know, I live in Southampton, and on Sunday, the same time as the London Marathon, is the Southampton Half Marathon, which is like London, only half as good. Clearly. Right. And I got a text message from the assistant manager down at the long-suffering Bedford Arms, which is where I, even though I've got Sky and I can watch his tone, I go downstairs and watch it in the pub and make an absolute tit of myself. And what I did, I got a text message from the manager saying, "You'll never guess who's in here." I went, "Jesus, who is it?" Like, so, "Who is it?" And they went, "It's the Sheffield Wednesday manager." Now, in that pub, I've met a couple of guys from Twitter who know I go there. I've met Raider Johnson, Lee Peacock, you know, these people that are down here for no reason. In fact, I even met Johan Folly down here and rented a flat off his step-parents. Now, so I've gone sprinting downstairs. It's literally right next to my flat. I've gone bombing downstairs, walked in, and it was... now, bear in mind, they live a long way away, and it was Stuart Gray. And and one of the lads went to me, "Are you not going to say hello?" I went, "No, you're all right."
Went back. You're going to say hello to Stu?
Did you ring up Beastie and say, "Beastie, I need you down here in 10 minutes"?
He'd have shanked him up fat. Yeah. "Are you not going to say hello, Fudge? You're not going to get a photo?" Or, "Ah, you're all right." And then went back upstairs. So I'm annoyed at Carlos for not being invented. Yeah,
he
was there with all his family's drinking tea in a boozer. Do you know what I mean? I'm not interested. Even in a pub on a day off, he's still vanilla AF. You know what I mean? Everybody else was getting sauced up around him, and he's gone, "Nah, do you know what? I'll just have a cup of tea, thanks." What are we talking about? Are we still recording?
But no, I think it's wonderful how Carlos has got himself into the Sheffield culture, and that video, it just looks absolutely marvellous, brilliant, love it, absolutely love it.
I tell you what, you've done well bringing that full circle there, Lord H, because I had no idea where we were.
Get the professionals on the job. Speaking of professionals, not really, but Wednesdayites have done a marvellous job at selling out the Fulham game. It was to be expected, wasn't it? Let's face it, this is going to be incredible. But of course, the tickets for the port game has now gone. So the old girl is going to be chuffing, rocking, isn't it? So if it does come down to that last game of the season, everything's stacked in our favour so far, isn't it?
You know what? It's going to be absolutely brilliant when results go on Saturday to the point where us and Fulham just need a draw. and we keep Leeds out of the playoffs. Oh, can you imagine? Imagine the anger from the Leeds fans.
What was that thing in the World Cup where Morocco got knocked out because there was a couple of teams just tossing it around?
It was either East Germany. So the group was West Germany, East Germany, Austria, and Morocco. Right. Yeah. Guess who's the odd one out there then? So basically, all three of them just completely coordinated an attempt to the point where I think the final game. Correct me if I'm wrong. I think it was actually East Germany against Austria, and they basically went, "We're just gonna pass it around our own."
Just passed it around
90 minutes, and they did. So
there's going to be a full rock in Hillsborough just watching that sort of game, you know what I mean? People sat around an Harry Enfield sketch.
It's going to be perfect because it means that James is going to be able to relive every moment of the match without forgetting anything because all of it is the same. It's just going to be Tom Lees and Glenn Leuvens passing forwards to Dave Jones, who's then going to pass back to them. That's it. Entire
happy
game.
With that. Happy with that.
It does have to be said, this evening, Wolves and Huddersfield have obviously played, and unfortunately Wolves didn't do us a favour this week, which is disappointing. They did lose 1-0 to Huddersfield, so they have now jumped back up to third, which means Wednesday have slipped down again slightly to fifth in the table, but he's still looking lovely at the moment. We've said it all season, haven't we? Well, I have. Anyway, we've been waiting to hit our form, and we have hit it at exactly the right time. Leeds have had their form. I'm assuming you guys have seen the lovely new hashtag doing the rounds from the Wednesday night. It's the LALA, Let's All Laugh at Leeds, which I am thoroughly enjoying. Absolutely beautifully enjoying. And of course, Yorkshire Radio, who are the least Yorkshire radio station I have ever heard in my life. Although we do love them dearly. Fudge, you've been on there before, haven't you, Obi?
Yeah, they stuck me on with a Huddersfield and a Leeds fan. And I literally mid-rant got cut off, which I was very unhappy about. But, you know, they've probably heard the show and it was probably, well advised.
I've been on before, but it's funny how we've not heard any added request to pop on older.
Yeah, weird that, isn't it?
Yorkshire Radio since Leeds have dropped out there. But no, it's lovely to see Leeds chuff it all up, and hopefully I shan't be eating my words in a few weeks' time. Right, chaps, that's all I've got for Wednesday news this week. Do you guys have anything different?
I have a couple of points actually, Lord Hillsborough, and. Last week, I was an absentee in the podcast, and you had I think you had Rich there, you had James, and was Vic there as well? I think it was just Rich and James.
Unfortunately, not. It was a grumpy old owls last week.
It was a grumpy old owls last week, and there was a throwaway comment made by Mr. Marriott there in reference to the chat we had about two or three weeks ago about the performances over points and that sort of thing. Now, at this time of season, obviously points are most important. I don't know about being right. You know what I mean? I don't know about being right. But there was a point made about negative football, about grinding out a result where you need one. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't feel like negative football is a bad thing. I just think it should be executed well. Does that make sense? I think you can grind out a result but still play good football. What do you reckon? Have I backtracked enough on that?
The Cardiff game was an example of negative football that was imposed on us, right?
Yes.
So we didn't have a choice with that. In order to win that game, we had to match the negative football that Cardiff played, right? I'm not against the idea of becoming a spoiler. When you're playing against a team that is demonstrably better than you, you play in a way that makes you win, right? I think this Wednesday team and the squad that we have and the tactics that we have mean that we don't have to do that very often. And I honestly don't think that we could be accused of having played negative football at any point this season off our own bat. I think at times we play very, very patient football. And I actually think that fans are conditioned to want to see some more direct play and play that is more overtly attacking. But actually, negative play for me is time wasting. It is stopping the other team from playing. It is interrupting play and all that sort of stuff.
That's
we don't do that. It's been a long time since I've seen a Wednesday team do that.
Okay, so let me bring you in on this then, Eddie. You can referee this one. And if I'm wrong, James, interject. What it was, James and I had a heated debate about two or three weeks ago, where he said it don't matter, points are points, mm-hmm. which I see his point. And I said, well, going forward, I think it would make the fans less jittery if we played better, fast-flowing, lovely football, or whether it be a bit defensive or whether we just absolutely go romping at people. Unfortunately, the last couple of games since we had that debate, we've had both. We've had the points and we've actually played quite well, even against Cardiff when they've tried to park the bus. So where do you sit on that fence, Eddie? Where do you sit?
I would specifically answer this with regard to the way that our fans react. OK, I think that we as Wednesday fans are conditioned to demand that, you know, endeavour, that excitement, that attacking football. You see how quickly the Hillsborough crowd turns when we are perceived to not be trying to win a game. Right.
Yes.
So for Sheffield Wednesday,
that's my
especially
point of it.
Yeah. Especially at Hillsborough, I actually think that it makes more sense to go balls to the wall a little bit because of the power that the crowd has to get behind the team and to intimidate the opposition, right? At Hillsborough, yes, I have a great deal of sympathy for you. All other things being equal, taking the crowd out of the equation, it's madness to play that way. What you need to do is play the way that is needed to get the points, because at the end of the day, getting the points mean you score more goals than the opposition. And the worst 1-0 victory is still better than the best 6-5 defeat. So
hang on, Eddie. Hang on. You're going to get splinters in your ass if you stay on this.
I'm not.
Anymore.
I'm
Come
not.
On now.
It's not. And you know what? Right. So in that case, you know, if you make me swear on my children's lives, would you sooner win every game and never enjoy a moment of it apart from the goals, or would you sooner enjoy every minute of it but never see Sheffield Wednesday achieve what we want to achieve, which is being back in the Premier League? Then I'll take the points every day. So I'm Team James. Hashtag
Team James. You've got yourself a follower there, Jamez.
You see that? Well, Funchot walked in the pub there, didn't he? And stuck his chest out and said, right, come at me. And I'm sorry, Fudgy, OB, but even James didn't have to fight his own battle then. We had banter.
I've been sat here enjoying a lovely beer. All right, what's next on your list then, Fudge? Come on. Ready for this?
What else did I have? I had something else, didn't I? It was Brighton and Hove, Albion and Newcastle. Now, you seem to be proud of Brighton going up.
I'm very pleased about Brighton. I'm pleased about Newcastle going up as well.
Yeah, the pair of them getting the fucking bin.
Yeah, 100% Team Fudge on that. Really dislike both of them.
No, hang on. Seriously. Whoa, hang on. You've got to hear me out on this because I have a theory, all right? Now,
Okay.
This little bit of blue sky thinking going on here. Brighton. What's Brighton's nickname? What are Brighton known as?
The Seagulls.
All right. Newcastle. What's their nickname? What are they known as?
Barco.
Yeah. Geordies.
Magpies. It's magpies, isn't it?
Coal miners.
Magpies. What do the Seagulls and magpies have in common?
Are you going down an ornithology route on this one, James? Is that what you're doing?
Don't accuse him of that. There's many things to accuse James of, but not that kind of sick.
Not
stuff.
An ornithologist.
Yeah. Bloody hell, you people should be in some sort of register.
I think you see my point. It's the year of the birds.
It's the year of the birds. Oh, yeah, because it went so well for Norwich, didn't it? Where, you know, the canaries are sat there languishing away. You've got the robins at the bottom of the league. Three can go up.
What do you want, five to get promoted out of from three promotion places? What are you talking about? There's only three teams that can go up. We're the only ones in the playoffs that are also represented by a bird. Ergo, it's us.
Oh, well, there you are then.
That's it.
You know, don't bother with tickets, kids.
2-0 James.
It's all right.
Game, set, and match.
You're the best. Love it. Right then, ladies and gentlemen. So, last little bit of Wednesday news. And unfortunately, this is awful, awful news. Obviously, there's nobody that's listened to this that won't have heard about the tragedy that happened at obviously, the Derby game. Massive, massive Wednesday night, apparently. Nigel Goodinson unfortunately collapsed at the Wednesday game and passed away. Awful, absolutely awful. Nobody should go to football and not come home. It's unbelievable. We've seen various tweets from family members and saying how much he was enjoying himself before the match and all that kind of thing. And it just unbelievably sad. He was a football coach himself as well for Handsworth Paramours, and he was only 58 years old, which is just no age these days. It's really, really not. Of course, the club are organising, and of course his friends and family are organising a round of applause for him at the Fulham game on the 58th minute, as he was 58 years old. So I urge all Wednesday fans, please get behind that as well. I'm sure we will. It goes without saying, really. And of course, our thoughts go out to his friends and family.
Whether you're celebrating a birthday, a wedding, or anniversary, maybe you've passed your driving test, or you've landed a new job. Well, whatever your reason for a party, the Riverside Cafe is the perfect location on Catch Bar Lane overlooking Hillsborough Stadium. To inquire about hiring us for your function, call 07989 856 054 or 0114 232 6121.
Right then, ladies and gents, so let's move on then, shall we? Last little thing we have to have a little chin wag about this evening is the upcoming Ipswich game as well, isn't it? Now, Ipswich, again, are one of those clubs that have essentially nothing but pride to play for, do they? They're not going anywhere, they're not going up, they're not going down, they're just there, aren't they, now? Obviously, Rotherham beat them at the weekend, which is chuffing ridiculous.
Lol.
But James made a good point earlier. Of course, they did beat Newcastle 3-1 as well, didn't they? So it depends which Ipswich is going to turn up when we play them, really.
Which Ipswich? That's good, that rhymes.
Yeah. If that could be one of the hashtags. Because you remember when we were uploading videos of the last time we played the team, we were going out and we kind of, it fell by the wayside, which never happens on this show. We start a new feature, innit? And it falls
by
the wayside.
I don't mean to be rude, but finding those chuffing videos is a right pain in the bottom. I love looking back at old Wednesday videos, but some of the more obscure ones, if you like, are just ruddy horrendous to find. So if you guys do have any memories of Ipswich, because it's always a memorable game when we play Ipswich, but yeah, please do get in contact and we shall do our very, very best to try and find your Ipswich memories there for you. Sorry, which I cut right across you there.
I have nothing to say about Ipswich. As we were just discussing off air then, that, you know, they've got one foot on the beach. They're already in Marbs to hashtag lad it up. You know what I mean? I'd be very surprised if they put a shift in. Yes, we've got Barnsley Mick, who I have no issue with whatsoever. You know, I love the Barnsley-based manager that they have. And it should be a comfortable win for us. However, let alone what Ipswich turn up, what Sheffield Wednesday turn up. Me personally, I would be inclined to rest a few players for the Fulham game. I know it's controversial given the gravitas of the game, but this is the type of dross I'd be piling out Jose Semedo for. Sorry, Jose.
What on earth are you talking about? Doing this just to try and rattle me? Are you just angling for another argument here? I've never heard so much utter shite in my whole life. Yeah. You would rest players for the game against Ipswich, which is our biggest game of the season. We're 2 points clear. Leeds will win their last two games. They'll get 6 points. Fulham have got a very good chance of winning on Saturday. And you're saying that we can afford to rest players for Saturday?
Yeah, let's rest
for the Fulham
game.
Let's
rest them all. We have
you're doing this deliberately now, aren't you?
I am. I'm being a little facetious. However,
God for that. I thought for a minute that you'd lost all. I mean, we all know there's not a huge number of brain cells in there to start with, Fudge. But seriously,
yeah. Well, you know, I'll. I think there is an opportunity to play Winnall and Rhodes, for example. But I don't think we should be resting players. I don't think we should be starting with Jose Semedo. I just wanted to get that in there. Just get it.
I think we should play all five strikers. Let's get them all in form heading for the playoffs.
Give them a game time.
You know, it could be one of the great championship games ever because, like you've said, Fudge, Ipswich are on the beach. They don't care anymore. They basically are regarding this as a display game. It's a testimonial. So let's just go absolutely batshit mental and go for the full-on Aussie RD League 5-0-5 formation. And yeah, let's just see what happens. Let's just fuck shit up. It's going to be brilliant. I cannot wait for this game.
let's get Bods up from the youth team to have a run about with a big boy.
It's time that Bods was given a chance. Now, at the age of 33, there is no reason he shouldn't start to look at first team football.
All we are saying is give Bods a chance. That's all we're saying.
In all seriousness, they are. This is a game against a team that have less than nothing to play for. They are clearly safe from relegation. They can't feasibly get into the top half. So, you know, they're looking at a season that Mick McCarthy has already given up and justified. He did that press conference, a few weeks ago where he was like, well, you know, I haven't been sacked because I've done a better job than other managers who have been sacked. So, fair enough, Mick. That's fine. and they've got an ageing team that has been with them for ages that are just marking time. There is no reason to suggest that they are going to give too much of a toss. I honestly believe that we can dictate things and that we can take the game to them and not win it to canter, because there are no games, even Rotherham, there are no games that are easy, but there are games where everyone goes through the motions. Everyone knows what they have to do. The Ipswich team know they have to at least show a bit of willing. But at the end of the day, they're quite happy for us to take the points and put a bigger gap between the teams that are going to the playoffs and Norwich. So, there's no reason why we wouldn't go there and take advantage of that sentiment. I'm hoping the weather's going to be nice, because to be honest, I'm on a bit of a long weekend down there anyway. So it would be great to have a big old sunny last away game of the season extravaganza. But even if not, even if it's pissing down and shitty, Saturday is the day that we rubber stamp our playoff place. Saturday is the day that those strikers continue to show that they can do it. And Saturday is the day that we start building that final push towards what are going to be three absolutely massive games that are going to take us back to the promised land.
I'll tell you what, is that the lyrics to Waka Waka by Shakira? Is that what you were singing?
Well,
today's the day, the strikers, they're all in line, they can't fight us. You get down, oh, you get down, hey. Samina, I'm in our chef for Wednesday. It's time for Barnsley,
there you go. Exactly. It's a summer carnival title. And that's it. I think we should get Shakira in there to do it.
Yeah. We'll borrow off Gerard Piqué. We'll sort it.
Oh, love it. And that's your 90s bit for our musical section of this
week. I think you'll find it's 2010s, that one, mate.
The 2010 World Cup, mate. 2010 World Cup. It's only the official anthem of the World Cup.
All it was? Yeah. That seems like chuffing years ago now. But, of course, Fulham are playing Brentford, as we mentioned last week as well. And Brentford have been great at home, but they've not been brilliant away, have they? Obviously, the one QPR 3-1, drew away at Barnsley, one apiece. They hammered Derby 4-0 at home. And, of course, it's a way to Fulham.
Derby game, though, isn't it? It's a Derby game, that.
Yeah. It's like us being away at Barnsley or something, isn't it, for our penultimate game of the season. It's tricky.
Fulham and Brentford are equally wanky middle-class suburbs in London, and so they really dislike each other because of property values, I think, more than anything.
I think it's property values and catchment areas. And,
yeah, absolutely, 100%. There's going to proper aggro between the two sets of fans, because the Brentford fans, their kids couldn't get into a really good school because they live just slightly in the wrong postcode area. Oh, can you imagine the seats?
Yeah, it's the great fallout of the cheese fondue fight of 2012. That's what it is, yeah.
Grew, yeah? You daft bastards. It should always be raclette.
Only you could make that joke, Kenny.
Look it up.
Target reference. It's obviously a winnable game. And then hopefully, everything goes our way. Yeah. I'm trying my very, very best not to get overly excited about this running. I really, really am. I'll be honest with you, I'm struggling not to get over excited about this running, because it's Wednesday and it's scary and it's weird. But chuff me, it's going to be brilliant, isn't it?
I can sober you up a bit if you want, because I am genuinely still worried, and I am generally a positive fan, as anyone that listens to this podcast regularly will know, sometimes annoyingly so, but the problem is that you've now got what, four clubs going for three playoff places.
Yes.
And yes, Leeds are in terrible form. However, they've got Norwich at home on Saturday, and Norwich obviously are a very up and down team in exactly the same way that Ipswich have been. And Leeds at home, generally their form's been pretty good. They've then got Wigan on the last day of the season, who will probably be relegated by then. So I think it's quite possible to see Leeds picking up four, maybe even 6 points from those two games. You've got Fulham, and probably not a game that they would pick to have as their penultimate game, is their kind of local derby game against Brentford, because Brentford will absolutely want to go there and get something out of it, and they will give them a, you know, a heck of a game. And then obviously last day of the season, they've got us. So I just think that there's going to be someone that's, there is going to be a team that's disappointed out of this. And at the moment, logic would say that it's going to be Leeds. But if Leeds beat Norwich on Saturday, it changes that picture a lot. So I'm adding a slight note of caution here to fans that are talking as if, well, it's done, we're in the playoffs. We're not. We're not in the playoffs. We've got a job to do on Saturday. We've got to go to Ipswich, who will not roll over and just let us win because they want to put more, a bigger gap between us and Norwich. That's, you know, a lovely sentiment, but it isn't going to happen. No. They will give us Mick McCarthy will be baying for blood. He will want to get one over on us, and he'll not want to lose the generally the very good record that he's got against us. His teams generally do pretty well against us. He'll want to keep that going. So it's wrong, I think, to consider it a foregone conclusion on Saturday. It's wrong to assume that we're going to make it into the playoffs, because there will be a team that misses out. It's inevitable. Huddersfield have secured their
Leeds.
Place.
It's Leeds. Yeah, it's Leeds. We're going to Wembley. It's Leeds. They're not doing it. Yeah,
we're rolling over Ipswich. There's less than 0% chance that we don't celebrate our playoff place on Saturday night. Leeds will not beat Norwich, and if they do, they will do a Leeds and somehow manage to contrive to lose against an already relegated Wigan Athletic on the last day while us and Fulham play out a draw.
It's all well and good you saying this, Eddie, but then you disappear for 6 months and we have to put up with the fallout from your nonsense that you say.
You know what?
If we lose Ipswich on
Twitter, not at TWWcast, anyone that wants to, come at me. I'm 100% confident on this.
Catch him on Twitter. How about that?
This is happening.
Can we put some money on this then? So if Wednesday lose at Ipswich on Saturday, you will not find some sort of excuse as to why you can't come on the podcast next week. You will guarantee us.
Well, that's the best.
100%
does the show.
I'm going to say absolutely yes. Right? I'm just looking at my calendar. So Wednesday night next week, I'm in Manchester because I'm off to see Bruno Mars. Right, so I cannot record on Wednesday. So as long as we agree that we're not recording on Wednesday, then yes, whatever happens on Saturday night, then I am. I'm definitely coming.
Piss on that. I'll get Bruno Mars on. We'll get him on. See what he's saying.
That'd be amazing.
Bruno. Hey, I'm all right. Wow. He's got the same voice as Mickey Mouse and Michael Jackson in my repertoire. But yeah, that's how Bruno Mars talks. What are you saying about them owls? Well, that was a Jermaine Jackson support. Yeah, that's the one. Yeah, what are you saying? I got a big quiff. Yeah, mint.
right then, ladies and gents. So that's going to bring us to an end of this week's show. Do any of you guys have any little bits before we end proceedings?
I have a little bit. Do you have one, James? Sorry, do you want to go first? My apologies.
No, I'll let you go first. You go first.
Okay, so my little bit is a big shout out to my cat once again. Knows where his loyalties lie. My cat, as you know, loves the shit, and I think we were recording once, weren't we, and he'd shat all over the carpet. Now, what he did this time, John Clark gave me a call the other day. I was picking him up to go into town. He lives in the local borough of Easley, which is about 10 miles away. Not even that. Anyway, I got to his house, and John went, oh, listen, since my dad had the shit can from Aston Villa, do you want some of this kit? Essentially, what he's saying was, I'm too thin for it. Do fudge you, you big stag. Want some of this kit? I thought, yeah, it'd be great. I'll have it for lounging around in. And yeah, Sporticus, my cat, named after Sporticus from Lazy Town, decided to shit it up. He's gone, oh, Dad, this isn't right. What's this here? I don't recognise this badge. Yeah, lovely Under Armour stuff it is. Shat all over it.
Jolly good show, Sporticus. All been top job that way. Jamesy, I believe you have a little bit there for us both.
Yeah, just to mention, there is a new blog now live on our website, which Jack, who's becoming one of our regular bloggers now, has written for us. And it seems quite timely as we kind of, you know, edge that bit closer to securing our playoff place, that he's written a bit his memories and recollections from the trip to London last May, which is almost brought a tear to my eye actually as I was reading it. So it's well worth having a look. The wednesdayweek.co.uk is our website, and if anyone is interested in writing a blog for us, you don't need any experience, just need to want to write about Wednesday basically, then drop me a line, james@thewednesdayweek.co.uk, and we'll take it from there.
Absolutely. Even I did some nonsense for that, and James actually made it look like a proper blog. So if you're rubbish at writing, by all means, James will sort it out for you. Well, he's like a teacher.
We did notice this the other day when you declared Derby as a boggy team. That was
a boggy team. No, that's exactly what I meant. They're a boggy team. No, absolutely. He just gets his little red pen out and just scribbles all over it. It's brilliant. Absolutely love it. Well done, James LB. Right then, ladies and gents, so that's going to bring us to an end of this week's proceedings. Mr. Eddie Wado, or Bean, if people want to go review over there on Twitter and tell you how bloody right you are about how marvellously wonderful we are and going to get to this playoff final and beat them and win the Premiership and then next year win the Champions League, where can we do that, LB?
So, as always, you can find me at Sausage Arms on Twitter, also on Instagram, which is where on a match day I usually post the general drunken escapades.
You
get
are
on.
So down with the kids, aren't you, Eddie?
Aren't you?
Hey, you know what? I may even do a Snapchat story on Saturday.
Shut up, man.
So, you know, just remember, you can tell me that I'm right, you can tell me that I'm wrong, but irrespective of any of that, this was the week where it was announced that Sheffield United are coming for us by signing Ched Evans. Just remember that. Whether you're positive or negative as a Wednesday fan, they've just signed Ched Evans.
So the same amount of money we signed Sam Winnell for. Let's not forget that.
Yep. You know what? In fact, I want to give a very quick shout out to the Sheffield Wednesday Supporters Club on Twitter, because they made me laugh massively yesterday when they said, cripes, when the Blades fans were saying, we're coming for you, I didn't think they meant while we were asleep in a Premier Inn.
Oh,
hashtag edgy.
Let's move on quickly. Fudgy, if people want to get over you over there on the podcast, I've done it again, over there on the Twitterage, all day, where can you do that?
Is that a mistake that's carried over for a week now? Where are they going to get hold of you on the podcast? Is
absolutely. Somebody asked me for my address just today and said, get me on the podcast. Where can we find your boy?
Find me on Twitter. I'm at Dan Fudge, or you can find me in the Bedford Arms, where James Addy 92 found me, the one that did the rather funny face swap with Depon Chancery, which in no way did I refer to it as. I think it was along the same humour as Mrs. Brown's Boys, I think I referred to it as, wasn't it? That's what I called it. But having met the man that done it, he's very lovely, and I love the video. It's one of my favourites.
Fantastic. Jamesy, or Bean, where can people get all of your nonsense over there on the Twitter?
On Twitter, James Marriott is my handle. Say hi, and if you are at Ipswich on Saturday, I will see you there.
Absolutely. Of course, you can get hold of me over there on the Twitter. It's at Lord H. That's LZRD_H. You can get all the podcast at TWWcast. Get all of us on Facebooks and all the rest of the usual places, YouTubes, etc., etc. Ladies and gents, it has been a pleasure as always. Thank you so, so much for joining us. Be good, be safe, and we shall see you
real soon.
Chance here, a great save by Turner from McClare. Mike Tannen. A terrific goal by Shannon.
Brexman against Jones. Get in.
You could have two goalkeepers in there that would have trouble with saving that.
No way. Right, chaps, that's all I've got for Wednesday news this week. Do you guys have anything different?
I'm talking away and I was on mute, so I'm going to start again.
That's quite all right.